Go ahead, please.
It's a pleasure. First of all, thank you, Linda Green and the University of Arizona, Matias, and Asunto del Sur for this extraordinary effort. It's a pleasure to participate in Diálogos del Sur. Once we get the technology under control, we'll move to a longer, more ambitious series. I think this is a fantastic opportunity for those of us interested in similar subjects to have a discussion and dialogue and then share it through some electronic format. My role is to pick up on comments made by Professor Gantz and by Marcelo Zaguer. I think Marcelo finished precisely where I should begin, that the trade regimens or the various trade organizations that have proliferated in Latin America over the last decade and more have been questioned and are to be questioned in terms of their effectiveness, which is where Professor Gantz placed his emphasis. And of course, from my perspective with geopolitics, as Marcelo indicated at the end of his comments, the real issue in any such pact, whether it's the political pact like UNASUR or an economic pact like MERCOSUR, is, first of all, does it meet the immediate needs of its members? We might refer to that in fancy language as the tactical goals or objectives. Is there reason to think that cooperation is useful to the parties? And, of course, MERCOSUR is a paradigmatic example of a trade agreement that begins with shared objectives and considerable early success built on the foundation of that those shared objectives, and a decade, the last decade, of disappointment and stagnation because the original consensus and overlapping trade agreements or short-term agreements have disappeared. And so what do you have in MERCOSUR is the failure to define what I prefer to call strategic objectives and goals. And where I'd like to point our attention for just the few minutes that I have is to insist that all of us ask about any agreement, whether it's NAFTA, FTAA, the Alianza del Pacífico, MERCOSUR, ALBA, lo que sea, why is it that nations want to get together and what are their goals and what actions can they engage in a cooperative manner? Integration per se goes back to Bolívar. It was one of his dreams. And many Bolivarians, both in the political sense and in the intellectual sense, think of Latin America as integrating. Why? Well, just because. The brotherhood of man, the French Revolution, shared goals, shared peoples, and so on. That's really not practical enough for most states and most governments today. And I would say that the ultimate goal of all regional organizations, whether they be political, trade-based, or simply partial agreements on tariffs and postal services, all agreements have as their core strategic goal the achievement of greater space and autonomy in the international community for the participants. It's what the political scientist calls agency. Do the nations of MERCOSUR, to take one example, have greater agency in the global system through membership in MERCOSUR? At one time, that was true. Today, I question it. And partly, that has to do with what Marcelo again clearly described for us as the weak institutional base. Contrast that, for example, to the European Union in the last half decade. How international institutions enable a trade group or a group brought together for various purposes to exercise agency and influence in the international community that goes beyond any set of regulatory agreements that might concern terms of trade, obstacles to trade, and so on and so forth. So the question that must be asked, whether it's ALBA, Alianza del Pacífico, or MERCOSUR, is how does this particular organization serve the immediate and long-term purposes of its members to increase their autonomy and agency in the international system. And as Diana Tusi has pointed out in a recent book, and as Marcelo again referred back to the notion, we're talking about a post-Cold War period. We can call it the post-hegemonic period, post-neoliberal period. It doesn't really make any difference. We're talking about an international system that's radically changed over what it was just 15 or 20 years ago. And everybody, not just Latin America, everybody in the world is trying to figure out how best to deal with the changing and evolving set of rules. So does Chile have enhanced agency in the global system through the Alianza? Almost certainly. Because as even in his brief presentation, Professor Gantz pointed out that when you start comparing nations, you find that Chile is ranked in the top five, easy to do business with, it's got the clearest regulatory system, and the list goes on and on and on. So Chile obviously leverages its success over the last two decades through membership in a wide variety of trade regimens. In other words, it's a better actor, it's a more effective actor in the international system through the use of these various trade organizations. We could take another case, Argentina, and go to the opposite extreme, where Argentina diminishes its effectiveness in the international system through its behavior in different international groups and regiments. And the current government in Argentina is wrestling with this conundrum and attempting to shift and find compromise positions so that it doesn't appear to be isolated from the international system, not just Mercosur, but the international finance market and so on and so forth. So we've got a variety of models available to study. The third, and I'll only mention it very briefly because of the constraints of time for this panel, but take as the third model to study. And what we're studying is the interrelationship between trade benefits that I call tactical benefits or tactical objectives and long-term strategic objectives on the part of the participants. If we look at Brazil, Mercosur begins as a trade, short-term trade benefit maximizing operation, as it did for Argentina. Over the years, in Brazil's hands, Mercosur was transformed into a geopolitical instrument that enhanced its leverage, one might even use the word hegemony, in South America. So it was important to Brazil to maintain Mercosur, but not important enough to compromise its short-term trade interests to meet and satisfy the needs of its partner, Argentina. So Mercosur as a trade organization has flatlined, has stagnated. But from the geopolitical point of view, Brazil has added its role in Mercosur to its relationship with Venezuela, first under Chavez, now under Maduro. Its efforts to become a link between ALBA and the rest of South America. Its role now in partnership with Chile, in UNASUR, and in CELAC, and so on. So Brazil is using what we might call a hub and spoke concept of belonging to trade organizations, always with a view to maximizing their long-term geopolitical interests. In a conversation I had with the former foreign minister, now Minister of Defense of Brazil, Celso Amorim, we were talking about this now at the time of the conversation about 5 years ago, a new phrase, post-hegemonic world, and I asked him whether Brazil had a sense that it had a role to play in South America in a post-hegemonic world, and he smiled and said, you know, the problem with the United States in Latin America is that it's a harsh hegemon. It's been imperialistic. It's used violence and military force to get its way. Brazil, by comparison, he said, is a gentle hegemon. Now, I don't know if Argentines and Chilenos would think that Brazil is a gentle hegemon, but the notion here is that Brazil deliberately, consciously maximizes its agency, its space, its influence, through multiple strategies, one of which is trade regulation. trade organization and trade partnerships. China, at one point, rose to be Brazil's most important trading partner. But that trade was based on a dramatic increase in Chinese appetite for Brazilian commodities. Marcelo also referred to the issue of commodities as one that we should take a look at, perhaps in another conversation, since our time doesn't allow us to do so now. So China's importance for Brazil increased radically over a relatively short period of time, 5 years, and Brazil sought to expand that new trade into a broader relationship. And they discovered, it really didn't, what shouldn't have been new or a surprise, because in Mercosur they had a similar experience with Argentina. They discovered in expanding trade with China that as they tried to increase trade beyond commodities, they hit a stone wall. And the Lula government, the trouble began in the last 2 years of the second term of Lula, President Lula. The Lula government had to change the terms of trade with China, the term, the treaties that it was negotiating, agreements it was negotiating, because the Brazilian domestic manufacturing sector had determined that it was not competitive with China, and that if free, quote-unquote, trade were to continue bilaterally, Brazil would become deindustrialized within a decade. And so that relationship had to change. And it's interesting, we'll see what happens among Chile, Peru, Colombia, and Mexico, and say China, or other nations in Asia, because Mexico has had significant issues precisely with China on the terms of trade and manufacturing. And they, last 2 years, they've negotiated some compromise positions with the Chinese, but for over a decade, the Mexicans were ready to stop trade with China because their manufacturing industries were being buried. So, to conclude, how do we know that these overlapping, sometimes competing, sometimes confusing trade regimens will work in the end? And the answer has to begin, you must begin to find the answer by asking whether any particular trade agreement meets the long-term strategic goals of its participants. Now, one last point. In order to answer that question using my suggested methodology or perspective, you presume that the participating countries, the governments, consciously formulate a foreign policy in which they think this way and talk this way among participants, opponents of the government, members of the government cabinet, and so on. You can talk from Buenos Aires to Santiago about this in a friendly manner and so on. And since the end of the Cold War, one of the reasons, in parentheses, that I question the term post-hegemonic, since the end of the Cold War, chronologically after 1990, many countries in Latin America have had excruciating difficulty in acquiring the self-conscious approach to formulating strategic goals. Not all countries in Latin America or in South America to this day are able to do so. And so until they are, it's going to be difficult for us to evaluate whether or not they're proceeding in a particular trade regimen in order to maximize their long-term strategic goals. Some countries are very clear about this, and it's another indicator or index on which Chile scores very, very high. Mexico is also very high. Brazil's a little confused about it, but only because they haven't settled their own internal domestic debate about what the model for strategic growth for global power should be. But they're working on it. We can't say as much. Some of the countries, ALBA, have formulated their geopolitical model as adversaries to the United States, and I think that's simply anachronistic. You can be against U.S. hegemony, but it's really hard to imagine an international trade regimen, for example, involving any country in Latin America that refuses to pay attention to the United States. You may not like the United States, that's not the issue, But can your economy grow? Can your national geopolitical goals be achieved if you somehow erase it from the blackboard of consideration? I think it's impossible. Anyway, thank you very much, Linda, Matthias. It's been a pleasure.